even though it's a beautiful spring day in the middle of campus, no one's out and about. That's probably because the coronavirus is keeping everyone stuck in their house. So what do you do when you're stuck at your house all day? You gotta smoke something. Today, I'm gonna give you some tips on how to smoke meat on a kettle grill, even though if you have an actual smoker, I'd recommend that instead. My buddy Eric is making a sandwich for lunch, and we're gonna grab dessert right after. Let's get started. Now, the grocery store is out of toilet paper and tofu, but they did have a whole pile of beef brisket waiting to be grabbed up. Now, this is a lot of meat for one person, but this brisket goes really well with all sorts of things that you might have stockpiled. You have a lot of mac and cheese? Throw some brisket on it. Is your ramen not beefy enough? Put some brisket in it. And of course, beer and brisket is a proven combination. So, today we're going to be learning how to smoke a brisket. Now, I can tell that this fat cap is a little thicker on this side, so I'm going to even it out by cutting off a bit of it. There we go, we've evened out the fat cap a little bit on our brisket. We want our brisket to stay nice and moist throughout the smoking process, so we're going to give it an overnight brine to really soak in some juices. So, for our brine, I'm going to use about 2/3 of a cup of brown sugar, and 1/3 a cup of kosher salt. I'm going to mix that in with 1.5 liters of boiling water. We don't want boiled beef, so to cool it down, I'm going to add some snow. Our brine is nice and cool now, so we're going to add in our brisket and let it sit overnight in the fridge. Alright, our brisket got a great rest overnight, and so did I. We're going to use about 3 tablespoons of brown sugar, 2 tablespoons of salt, 2 tablespoons of paprika. We're going to add a little bit of onion powder and garlic powder, some cayenne, ancho chili pepper, and of course we're going to crack pepper on top. Alright, get ready to roll up your sleeves and rub down some meat. I want to make sure to get the sides too. Alright, that is looking good. Before I forget, let's crack some pepper on top there. Well, it took a second to dig out the grill, but we've got our chimney, so we're ready to get our coals started. We want to put all the coals on this side of our grill in the grill tray. We want this fire to go for a long time, so I'm going to add some extra unlit charcoals now. Those will burn later in the day. I'm also going to add some soaked wood chips. I have here some mesquite wood chips, and what these are going to do is really give it that smokiness, that mesquite flavor. I'm going to add a water pan. That's going to continue to help it to stay moist and not get too much direct heat. I'm putting my water pan over the top of the coals. Again, we've got aluminum foil in between the coals and our brisket. And it wants to be on the opposite side of the grill as our coals. Coals over here, brisket over here. Self-isolation, that's what we're all about today. All right. Now you can see some good smoke coming, so I'm going to put the top on. I'm going to want to check the internal temperature throughout the day, and we want this to get up to 250. Alright, smell that smokiness, delicious. Now we just let it go for an hour or two. We want to check every couple hours on our brisket. Just because it's quarantine doesn't mean you can't meet new people. For instance, I got my buddy John here to keep an eye on the brisket while I was inside. So, he told me it's about ready to go. So, let's take a look at it. Remember, we want our grill to be at about 250 in here. You can check that with a thermometer. So, I need to refill my coals now that they've burned down. I'm also gonna add more liquid to my water pan. I've got here some of my remaining brine and some apple cider vinegar. You gotta put in deliciousness to get out brisketness. That'll evaporate and keep it nice and moist. about halfway through the cooking process. I'm gonna go ahead and flip my brisket. You want all the sides to be evenly cooked.
And I just got it off the grill. It needs to rest for at least half an hour and preferably up to an hour before you slice it. See all these juices? You want them to stay there. So I'm gonna wrap this back up and let it sit for a while.
This meat is bursting with flavor and absolutely delicious, but it's a little tougher than I'd like. I cooked it for 10 hours to an internal temp of about 180. You could probably cook it for maybe 8 hours to about 160.
Well, hi, I'm Eric, Will's former roommate. First, I'd like to give a shout out to LSU Tigers football. 2019-2020 national champions, and if the virus keeps it up, we'll be national champions 2 years in a row. We're gonna start putting our ingredients together to make a muffaletta inspired sub. We're gonna start by chopping up about 2/3 of a cup of pimento stuffed green olives. In the great tradition of southern cooking, I say 2/3 of a cup, but what I really mean is about however many olives you think is good. So we're also going to work with Kalamata olives. You can get them with the pits, but then that's just more work. And you're also going to use 2/3 of a cup of these guys. So, even olive to olive ratio. Also, another fine tradition when cooking in the southern style is you eat your stuff while you make it. I'm from Louisiana, from Madisonville, and I laugh whenever guys like Will say healthy southern cooking because I just don't think that exists. So Will has this really nice food processor. Mini food processor that we're going to use to assist us in our time of need. So you just cut up the olives in big enough chunks and we'll process them as we go. They don't have to be super small. Depends on how much you like the olives, to be honest. So two more ingredients that we have are parsley and oregano. We're going to chop these up finely in the food processor with the last batch of olives. And this is just going to add some more flavor to your olive salad. Okay. So now you have the makings of a pretty extensive olive salad. Pieces are small, but not too small if you don't want them to be. And now we're going to add the last few ingredients to this olive salad. Garlic. We're going to chop these up and mince them. Ground black pepper. Sounds kind of gross to some of you, I know. Anchovies. Underrated ingredient though. I'll use two because I made a little bit more. And instead of cutting it, we're going to use the flat part of a knife or the side of the knife or even a spoon, and you're going to smash it. It's a very smashable thing. Almost as smashable as Alabama's football team was this year. Go Tigers. Mix it up some. Try to distribute the flavor of the anchovies in your olive salad. So mix it up a lot more than some. But you definitely need at least half a cup of olive oil. Or about half a cup. Then if you need more, go ahead and add more to your heart's desire. And so now you have basically a workable olive salad. It's pretty oily, but that's what this is about. This sandwich is all about salty deli meats and oily olive salad. All right, so now that the olive salad is done, To me, that's the hard part. Now, the easy and fun part is up, and that's assembling the sandwich. So, we don't have a real muffaletta bun, so all we did was we picked up an Italian loaf from the store. We have two types of cheese. So, one, we have mozzarella cheese sandwich slice, and we have provolone cheese sandwich slice. So, what I like to do is I like to have stratified layers of meat and cheese. So I'll go with some mozz first, and then I'll go with some meat. So we have four different kinds of meat. One we have is something called mortadella. Now we add some more cheese. Next meat we're gonna add, Genoa salami. I like to go heavier on the salami. That's just me. Now what I'm gonna do, just to switch it up, is I am going to add some of our olive salad at this point in the sandwich. If you're really into the olive salad, you can add a whole bunch, because I'm gonna add more at the end too. I'm into the olive salad, so I always like a lot. And then we're gonna add more cheese on top of this to kind of trap this olive salad in. For another fancier meat, we have something called capicola. It's pretty fatty, very flavorful, so be careful with how much you add. One more for good measure. And one for me. The last meat we have is pepperoni. Pepperoni, just like the salami, I go heavy on. It's not just because the slices are smaller. I just like pepperoni on this. Now on top of this, more olive salad. We're gonna make this a hot sandwich. So we're gonna wrap this bad boy in some foil. I'm gonna set our oven to 375. And we're going to let it bake in the foil for 15 to 20 minutes. And after about 15 to 20 minutes, this is going to be more done than Alabama's football season was after losing to Auburn. I like my cheese melted and my sandwich done. Some things to remember is, one, LSU is the reigning national champions in football and the best team of all time. Two, make sure you're practicing social distancing and staying at least 6 feet away from each other. Will, you good down there?
Yeah, I'm good.
All right, you ready for the sandwich?
Yeah.
All right.
For dessert, we stop by the Cookie Jar for some delicious cookies. Remember to support your local restaurants during this quarantine. They miss you, and you miss their food.
All right, action, cookies. These cookies just smell amazing. Cookie Jar has a whole lot of good stuff there.